This conference will now be recorded.
And I will share the screen too. Okay. So we are all good. Let's begin. So before we talk about interview preparation, very basic thing is, how do you access my content? I see some of you are still confused on how to access the material or what is the right way to access the material. Now, sometimes I wonder that, why do we face that issue? But again, anyways, let me try to highlight that. You need to log in to your Gmail account, which you have given me, and say classroom.google.com. And as soon as you do classroom.google.com, you will see boxes like this, be quiet. You click here, and then some of the people start reading the content from the streams. See, stream you should not check. You should always check classwork, where you see the content organized in a proper manner. And then you follow this order, whatever is given. If you go in stream, you won't get to know what you have to read. Even though content is there on stream also, but it's not ordered properly. It's basically in reverse order. So you need to always check under classwork. I've highlighted that earlier too, and some of the people are still confused on how to see the material. So that should not be a confusion any longer. And this is quite straightforward. So this is about Google Classroom. And for the batch which started on July 3rd, every week you will see one box created for this, right? As of now, you see this box for week one. For week two, there will be another box. For week three, there will be another box. From the batch starting July 3rd, it will be like this. For other batches, it is different. They know about it. Okay. So that's about the Google Classroom on how to access it properly. Now, second area of concern is, in Slack, I see people tag me. There is nothing wrong with tagging me, but what happens is, then if someone else who knows the answer will hesitate to answer it, because I am tagged, they will think that, okay, Sumit sir should only reply because he's tagged. So let's not make a habit of tagging me, because that is like a platform I have given to you, so that we can have a healthy discussion. Some of you can post the answers, questions, and others can post the answers. If no one is able to post, I'll be doing that. In the end, I will take the ownership of making sure your doubts are resolved, but we have to follow a particular protocol that we are keeping it open for everyone to solve it. In the end, it comes down to me if no one is able to solve it. So this area of concern I just saw, and some of the people highlighted me, sir, that I know the answer, but I am not replying just because that person has tagged you. So it seems bad. I mean, that's what they said. So do not tag. Let it be open for everyone. I think some of you have to keep yourself on mute. Okay. So do not unmute yourself. Okay. So this is about Slack channel. Please do not tag. Do not feel bad about it. It's just a good practice that we are following. We are asking that anyone who knows the answer can reply. Okay. So with this, we have talked about two points, that how to access the content, number one. Second is how to use the Slack channel in a proper way. And I'm not sure if everyone is aware of Slack channel or not. Let me quickly show that, because I see some of the people have not even seen that. Let's see. So you see this week three, right? So every time new week will be created. For example, week three, for example, I'm not highlighting anyone. I mean, this is general, one of the inquiry, but everyone is tagging me. That's the protocol we are following. We see this, right? So nothing to pinpoint here, but do not tag so that it gives others also the scope to answer. Now you can see probably no one has answered because the question came to me and I might be busy with some other activities, so I could not see it. If this was not tagged, others would have pitched in and would have answered it. Again, this is not to highlight one particular case, but in general I am talking about. And when week 4 will start, the fourth group will be created. For people in May 29, this is the forum. And for people in April 17, this is the forum. But for people who started new, July 3rd, they will have one forum for each week coming like this. So that we have only relevant discussion going in each week. Okay. So this is about the Slack channel. Now coming to interview preparation, I think this is the most awaited topic, I believe. Interview preparation. Now, you know, this is a long journey which we are doing. It's not a short course. It is a 18 weeks course. Along with that, after every 5 weeks or whenever I feel, I'll be giving one week break so that you get time to revise. So might be, let's say we have 4 weeks break in between, plus 4 weeks, just to make sure things are not going over your head and you get enough time, it will come down to 22 weeks. And when you say 22 weeks, it's a big duration. It's close to 4.5 to 5 months. Now, this is a very good time. If we utilize this time well, we will be very much prepared. But the thing is, or the challenging point is, we do not have just one thing to learn. We have so many things to learn, right? If someone who begins his journey with big data, he might be confused also that there are so many things, 100 of things, what to do, what not to do. So whenever you started before that, you might have so many questions. Sir, there is Hadoop, there is Spark, there is Kafka, there is Hive, there is HBase, there is Scoop, what to do? What is more important? That will be your concern. So the thing is that, whenever you are prepared, make sure you have the right focus. Not everything is equally important. Some things are more important than the others. You need to have a priority set in your mind. For example, if you ask me what is the number one priority, we are learning 100 things. What is the number one priority? I would, without any hesitation, say Spark with scale. There is no doubt regarding this. There is nothing more important than this in the entire course. Spark with Scala. Now, you might have a concern, how much Scala we should know? See, Scala you should know to a level that you are able to answer in interviews and to a level that you are able to code in Spark easily. So, as a language, if you take Scala, you can waste 5 months in this. But that's not our intention. Our intention is to crack the interviews or whatever they ask in interviews. We should be prepared for that. Plus, we should be able to write our Spark code comfortably. To that extent, we should know Scala. And whatever I am covering, Scala, you do not have to do anything beyond that. See, always there is scope to do more. But only do that more once you are fully sure about my content. Because I am very confident my content will cover most of the things, if not all. Right. So first priority should be give importance to my material. If I'm covering something, that means it's important. If I'm not covering something, that means it is not important. As simple as that. If I feel something is important, I will include it as part of my course. Now, the only thing is I'm not covering that because I feel other things are more important than this and we should be covering other things. For example, in week one, I see in all the batches, there is a concern that some people raise admin related question. Now, big data developer itself is such a vast field that why do we want to look from admin side? And that's nowhere in picture at all. No one will even ask you that, okay, how exactly we will handle if a node goes down, what we need to do, all that. That's not required at all. So keep the focus from a development perspective. Do not jump into admin side. It's good to know everything. But again, it's not good to put hands in all things and not knowing everything in depth. Rather, put your hand in big data developer architect course. Do it well. So keep the focus in mind. Do not get deviated. Spark with Scala is the number one choice. And let me tell you, this is easy compared to your MapReduce, your Hive, your Scoop, and more interesting. So easy, as well as interesting. Now, people who are doing Spark with Scala can easily tell that this is way more interesting than what we have learned in this entire course. Right? Now, Scala, we should be mostly focusing on functional aspects. Functional aspects are the most important thing you should know as a big data developer. For example, what is a closure? What is the anonymous function? All those things, which you will learn eventually. So functional aspects is the top choice. Now, Scala, from an object-oriented perspective, you should know only things which are asked in interviews. Object-oriented preparation just for sake of interviews. Normally, you do not use or write much of code in object-oriented style, but whatever is required in interviews or whatever is asked in interviews, we should be prepared for that. I have collected a bunch of questions which are asked in object-oriented, and if you prepare that, that's good enough. But again, if we take these two, functional aspects holds more precedence, because this is the style of programming we consider when we solve our problem. This is a natural effect. So this is about Scala. Now, talking about Spark. See, in Spark, again, I would say there is a lower level construct, which is the RDD style. Some of the people might not be able to relate because they are in their week three and all. That's fine. So one is RDD style. Other one is a data frame style. Now, which one is more famous these days is data frame style. So make sure you are very comfortable with data frames. However, the questions will still come on RDD style because here you get to know the internals of things. But most of the times in your project, you will work on data frames. But in interviews, expect questions on RDD also. So Spark is the top priority, and we need to do a bunch of optimizations, learn various optimizations. See, in interviews, sometimes they ask, what all optimizations you have used in your project? Now, even though sometimes you are aware of some of the optimizations, but it might not click that time. So keep this list handy, that if someone asks you, you need to tell some 3 or 4 points that I use this in my project. That is very important. Because sometimes you are aware, but dynamically, if they ask you something randomly, then sometimes it does not click and you feel lost. There they will get to know that you have not actually worked on it. And I would say, whatever code they ask you to write in interviews is not very hard. It's just that we should do little bit hands-on based on whatever material I'm giving. That is sufficient, I'm saying, more than sufficient. You do not require anything beyond that. But make sure whatever I'm giving you, you practice that yourself. If you do not practice, then even a simple code you won't be able to write. You might be able to relate that, okay, I can understand this, but your hand won't work there. I mean, kind of you will be stuck. So you should not show that. So Spark with Scala is the number one priority. Now, second priority in this course is Hive. There is no doubt about it. Some of the companies still use Hive extensively. An interview might start on Hive and end on Hive. This is how important Hive is. So again, Hive you should do in a lot of depth, and you should again do all the optimizations in a proper way. You should be very clear on the optimization. So for example, partitioning, bucketing, this is very simple. Then join optimizations, right? File formats, and many others, whatever we have covered. So in Hive, they won't ask you to write a normal query. Rather, they will ask you a concept that, okay, this is my scenario. On this column, should I do bucketing or partitioning? That's the mode in which it will go. So I hope you can understand these two are the topmost priorities. After completing, of course, if you have to revise something, it should go in this order. The third thing is Scoop. This is also equally important. And Scoop is very simple, ingesting the data and again sending it back. how our scoop import is what we use majorly. Now, when you go for interviews, they won't actually ask you write this scoop command. Rather, they will ask you a question scenario based. What if my scoop job is not performing well? What can be the reason? Then you might have to say that, okay, might be outlier came and the bound well query is something which is disturbed. We need to tweak that just to make sure each mapper works on equal amount of data. That's the kind of answer they expect. So interviews will go more on logical side rather than syntactical side. Sometimes we are so hooked with the syntax that we keep on forgetting the logic. No, I would say logic holds the first priority, syntax holds the second priority. Even if you write the pseudo code in interview, they will accept that. If you give some idea, right, that's okay. They do not expect you to write the actual syntax. But logically, you should be very clear. They might give you a scenario, my scoop export is failing. What can be the reason? How to make sure my table does not get disturbed when scoop export fails? So this is the kind of things they will ask you, more logic based rather than syntax based. Right? Now, these days, you should know one cloud platform also from a big data perspective. Now we have three important platforms, AWS, Azure, and GCP. Right? AWS is by Amazon, Azure is by Microsoft, GCP is by Google. Now, if you have to learn among this, I would say AWS is the top choice. However, Azure is picking up very quickly now. But still, the market leader is AWS. That's why in my course, I go with AWS. Now, I would say this is important, but not that important. Definitely, this is something which is a plus, or this will give you advantage over others. If you know AWS Big Data Services, this will give you advantage over others. So definitely in this current industry trends, you should be aware of at least one cloud provider from a big data perspective. From our side, we will be talking about EMR, Redshift, Athena, Glue, and S3. Other things are not relevant. I mean, if you try doing all, it is endless. Our intention is not to master all of them, but to master the ones which are required. This is good enough. And this will really give you an edge over others who do not know this. Right? So this is how it is. Now, apart from that, some of the companies look from streaming side also. Not all companies, might be two companies out of 10. But if they are looking more for real-time data or streaming data, then they expect you to know two things. One is structured streaming, Spark, structured streaming, and Kafka. This goes as a combination or a package. You should know both of these. But again, out of 10 companies, two to three companies might have requirement. Out of 10 might be three companies will look for this. So definitely this is also a good area to cover. See, our intention finally is that we should be eligible for most of the companies, or we should be satisfying the criteria for most of the companies. Right? So if you know these two things, this gives you a really good edge over others who do not know this. Because everyone who is going will be aware of Spark with Scala, will be aware of Hive and Scoop. Now, these things are additional, which not everyone knows. And this can really improve your chances. Now, apart from this, you should know about one NoSQL. You should know about one NoSQL, preferably HBase. The reason why I'm saying HBase, because this is very easily integrated with Hadoop, or it's automated there. You do not have to do any extra setup to do that. And it is very, very easy, right? So this is for quick searching. Now, whatever I have covered in my material, you do not have to see anything beyond that. They will ask you HBase architecture, like what is Vol, what is MemStore, right? All those things. They will ask you the architecture of HBase, that how it works. How exactly is the delete performed? When in HDFS, we cannot actually do some changes, then how exactly delete is working? How exactly update is working? All those kind of questions they will ask. Again, though, they won't ask you to write HBase syntax. So most of your interviews won't go syntactically. However, in Spark with Scala, they might ask you to write a code. In Spark with Scala, they might ask you to write a code. In Hive also, they can ask you to write some simple query. But for other things, they might not ask you anything from coding point. They will ask you architecturally or logically. So this is how it is. Now these forms the important things, and you should do these things in this order. So sometimes you will be confused that course is done. Now I want to revise. I am feeling that I am forgetting the previous things. What should I do? Go in this order, whichever I am showing. Right? So this is how it is. And do not get hooked to syntax. I will continuously keep on saying that, because sometimes we try to forget what is the prioritized thing. We need to prioritize things because we are learning 100 different things. You cannot master all 100 things the same way. Rather, you need to master 20 things out of it properly. 80 things, if you know to an okay level, that is good. Right? So if you really want to master, I would say master at least these three. And then other things, if you know to a okay type of extent, it's good enough. Right? Because 70% of your interview might be just based on this. Now coming to your resume. I see that sometimes people tend to keep a lot of things in their resume just to get some calls. See, getting the calls is not the only thing. After that, you have to justify that also, right? So I would say, do not go in that mode of getting a call, just simply. Rather, put whatever you know. If you are 100% sure, then only put it in your resume. Do not try to make it a four-page resume unnecessarily. So put only what you know. Because most of the times, interviewers take your resume and they will see, okay, you have mentioned Kafka. Let me ask. If you have not mentioned Kafka, it's okay, they won't ask you, right? So if you have mentioned something and you do not know, that will leave a really bad impression. So only put things which you are very confident at, right? Do not put unnecessary things, and do not try to make a resume more than 2 pages. I mean, it's okay if your personal wish is to make a 8-page resume, but no one reads that. Make it a concise resume so that people can read it and ask questions related to that. And do not put unnecessary things here. I'll be sending you some formats of resume for some of the candidates who get placed from my end. And you can just see and convert your resume based on that. That stage will come later, not now, anyways. I hope this is clear. Now, in your resume, the most important thing is project. Now, if let's say you have more than 3 years experience, I ask you to showcase 3 years experience. Because with my course, you can easily showcase that, or you will be that much confident. But again, project should be meaningful. It's not that you put something very, very dummy and you are not aware. In the end, I will be giving you one end-to-end complete pipeline where you will get a complete picture. But you need to demonstrate that properly in your resume so that people should get an impression that you have done in your company. Now, for example, you are in a healthcare industry. Now, you should not showcase a project of retail, right? It should be based on your domain so that it looks realistic. I will help you with that, do not worry. But you need to be very careful at this area. And whatever project you have mentioned, you should be very clear about it. I mean, you should be able to handle all the edge cases. It's not that they ask you a question and you get stuck. A very important area when you go for interviews. Sometimes interviewers start the interview by saying, can you tell me what projects you have done, and start from there. So be very, very confident with that. So these are the few areas which I feel I should be highlighting you, because in the end you will be doing N things, but not all the N things are equally important. That's what the idea I want to communicate. My course is very focused, and that's why I try to ask people that keep your doubts related to my course. Because if you try to deviate, then there is a lot of scope to get deviated. Do not do that. If I feel something is important, I might include it as part of my course. So keep the doubts relevant to my course. Do not try to get involved in other things. Once you complete the course, then look at other things, fine. But for that time, do this and do not plan to see anything extra. That's what I would like to communicate. And in the end, sometimes they ask you questions that, okay, what is your role in your current project? Current project. See, normally in startups, we might get a chance that we work on end-to-end project. Very rare. Otherwise, we get a particular module to work. Right? For example, if let's say your project is Kafka, your project is Spark, you might be picking the Spark thing. Now, I see for people who have not actually worked and try to simulate a project, they try to showcase that they have worked on all the things, which looks to be fake, which looks to be very unrealistic in most of the scenarios. If you have actually worked on it, fair enough. But if you are beginner in big data doing a course and showcasing yourself, do not say that you have worked on all aspects. Only try to highlight few points so that the questions also will be restricted to those points, and it will look much more realistic. Right? So these are the things which I can think of right now. But the key takeaway that I want to tell you is, do not lose focus. Go with whatever I am saying, and do not try to do extra things for now. Once the course is done, try exploring whatever you want. But till that time, think that we need to master whatever sir is teaching. And I am sure with this, you will be able to grab multiple of. Right? So this is how it is. So I think we are running short of time also, and I am done with whatever I wanted to convey. So I know some of you might have some doubts. We can cater it in the doubt clearing session, which we will have starting in 10 minutes. So you can hold on for your doubts for that session. So let me stop the recording and directly let's meet in 10 minutes in the doubt clearing session. I hope this was useful for you to get a quick overview